Please welcome Liz Williams.
All right, so no secret, we've all been hearing today, and we all heard last year at the VA Immersive Summit, that people want VR headsets in the home, right? Those people are veterans, they are caregivers, they are clinicians, they're people all over, right? So a little over a year ago, my co-innovation specialist, Sheena Strong, who is actually at the Little League World Series this week with her son, began asking ourselves, why can't we? Why can't we create a standardized process to be able to get these VR headsets in the home? Our facility was always an early adopter of immersive technology. We participated in pilots with virtual reality, different CRADA opportunities and things of that sort. And what we began to hear from clinicians and veterans at the end of those pilots and the end of those CRADAs is, okay, now what? We have to get the devices back. What if we want to keep them? In some scenarios, they were able to keep them. In some scenarios, we were able to figure out ways to be able to purchase a singular device for a veteran. And so she and I started talking. We said, let's just figure this out. It's time to figure it out. So a little over a year ago, we began talking with Caitlin and Ann and started connecting with folks like Matt and Peggy at the National Prosthetics Office to think about the regulatory requirements and what that would take. Fast forward to January of this year, we went live with the first standardized process for VR home use at our facility. We were very excited to do that, but we were also a little nervous because it was new and there were so many things that we were going to have to learn. There were things that we were going to have to change and iterate on as we moved along. And I'm happy to say that we've done that since January. We've learned since January and we're continuing to learn on a daily basis. And so a little bit about what that process looks like that we've created for our healthcare system is that we went live with just a few use cases initially. We wanted to start small. We wanted to start with something that was manageable, again, that we could learn from and grow upon. And so we are using VR and home use scenarios right now for pain, anxiety, depression, boredom, stress, and cognitive. And so the way that it works right now is that clinicians see veterans in the clinic. They evaluate them for virtual reality. Some of them have already used it in several clinic sessions prior. And the clinician then talks with the veteran about utilizing VR in the home. Do they think that it would be effective for them? They do the education with them in the clinic. We have VR headsets situated in all of our clinics, inpatient, all of our CBOC locations as well. They then document that in the electronic health record. Concurrently with the home use process work that we were doing, we also worked to standardize and streamline our VR documentation. And so now our clinicians are able to do all things VR with just one virtual reality note. This means they can document all of their VR sessions, whether they're in clinic, they're inpatient. They can do their VR home use consult from this note. Their return to clinic order is auto-populated from that consult within that note. I'm a nurse, again, by background. I like things to be easy. I know that clinicians need things to be easy. I know that they need to be intuitive. So that was some concurrent work that we did there. So they're able to evaluate them in clinic. They're able to document that education and that session in the clinic. That note auto-populates the home use consult if indicated. That consult has all of the requirements as necessary for prosthetics. That consult then goes over to prosthetics. Within that process, there is a return to clinic of 90 days for them to come back and see their provider. This can be done virtually or in person. Prosthetics orders the device, it's then shipped to their home, and the device is kept by the veteran. It's an actual, it's an owned device, it's not a leased device. When we went live with this process, we went live with just one vendor to start out. Again, we wanted to start small, learn before we kind of grew the process. So some of the implementation steps that we took were considerations for purchase of VR devices and what device were we going to utilize when we went live. So some of the things that you'll need to consider if you decide to implement this process at your facility is the ease of use. This is the home. This isn't the clinic. This isn't where there's going to be providers or folks that are standing hand in hand with them to be able to walk them through utilizing a VR headset. So you need to make sure that it's going to be a device that's easy to use, something that's intuitive. You need to consider the Wi-Fi capabilities. We've heard that time and time again today. We've also heard about the rurality of, you know, veterans and where they're located. I myself just got reliable Wi-Fi this year, okay? So it's a real struggle for folks. So that's something that you need to consider when thinking about VR headsets to utilize in the home. Data collection, privacy, security, that's all important. Initially, the device that we went live with is the Penumbra Real Eye series, and so it does not require Wi-Fi. It's pretty intuitive to use, doesn't have controllers, and it doesn't collect or share data. So that's why we went live with that device first. And then what are the specific use cases that you're going to use it for in the home? If you're going to be using it for rehabilitation therapy, you might need to be looking at specific devices. If you're going to be using it for short-term versus long-term, would it need to be a lease device versus an own device? These are all considerations and questions that you need to ask yourself. And then cost, just like Matt was just talking about. We want to make sure that we're being good stewards of taxpayer dollars, right? So that's something that we need to consider. Like you said, we're not constrained really by that. We're here for healthcare, good healthcare, quality healthcare. But it's something that you've got to consider. It's something that you've got to talk about with your team. And then secondly, collaboration with your site's CAC team. I can't tell you how critical this is. Shout out to Rachel Duncan on our team in Biloxi. She was wonderful to work with. We've created a template that has all of the things that are required of prosthetics for a VR home use consult. Now our clinicians aren't seeking out those one-off, you know, consults like I talked about. They're not just creating a one-time order and hoping that they've checked all the boxes and crossed all their T's and dotted all of their I's. And then having collaboration from them to help with that note, you know, build that you need to be able to document that, as well as the data. We've heard how important the data is. Just last week, we put the finishing touches on a VR home use data dashboard. Anu and I are going to talk about that real soon. And so that's really important, especially as you implement new processes moving forward and you evaluate those processes, like Matt said. We've got to be able to know and follow up with these veterans to make sure they're using these devices. We're not just putting them in their home and they're sitting on a shelf collecting dust and we're spending all of these dollars and all these efforts, but they're not getting utilized. And then thirdly, developing VR policies. Again, concurrent processes. So we were working on VR home use case, and we were also cleaning up all things VR at our site within that year's work. So we created an inpatient and in-clinic virtual reality SOP that guides all things VR for our healthcare system. And then we created a VR for home use memorandum, since this was a new process to guide it for clinicians. And then fourth, our go live and rollout. This consisted of education, promotion, and evaluation. Our first step was education. This is probably the most critical step, to be honest with you. And even though we spent a little over a year working on the whole process in general, this was the hardest and remains the hardest step. It is absolutely crucial to have buy-in from your staff before you start something new with them. So we wanted to really, really focus on staff and clinician education in the first couple of months of go live and thereafter before we moved into promotion for veterans. That was so that we had their buy-in and they felt supported and that we could make any tweaks that we needed to make. We thought of everything, right? But we know we're not perfect and we had to make some changes in those first couple of months on some various things. And so we did education from any which way that you could think about it. We did education on all employee calls. We did open houses. We did service level meetings. We did huddle meetings. We went to all of our CBOC locations. We did one-on-one meetings. We did Teams meetings. We did education ad nauseum, but it still wasn't enough. Later, we decided to create some open hours to help kind of mitigate some of those Teams messages and things that we were getting throughout the day. We also felt that it would help if we created a SharePoint site for folks to be able to have quick reference, and so we did that pretty quickly, and we had some recorded trainings located there for folks, and so that's really helped a lot as well. After we spent the first couple of months on education, we moved into promotion. This was really important here. We started going to some veteran town halls, as you can see there, and then we went to some of our local veteran service organizations to spread the word and awareness about this new process that was available for veterans. We worked with the Immersive team to create some graphics. Fun fact, that's my husband's uncle wearing that headset in his home. He was so excited to use a VR headset for the first time, and that was his first time to use it. And so we created these banners, and we've placed them in all of our waiting rooms at our main campus and at all of our CBOCs. And so now veterans are coming in, and they're asking about it. And our clinicians know about it. They didn't get bombarded with the ask before they knew about it or before they were comfortable with it. And that was really, really critical to our success starting out. And then thirdly, evaluation. One of the things that we wish we would have done is created our data dashboard prior to our go live, but again, we just put the finishing touches on it last week. But that's really going to help us as we evaluate this program moving forward. So far, actually last week, right before I left, we were at 100 home use VR consults that have been processed thus far. So you can see we had a really slow start in January and February, and we've had a steady uptick since then. We anticipate that this is just going to continue to grow as word spreads and awareness spreads. Again, we get lots of calls from clinicians still. They're attending our open hours still. You know, the education is just a continual process. This is a breakdown of the use cases that we're seeing so far. Anxiety, pain, and stress seem to be kind of the leaders for home use. And some of the early feedback that we've received is, I really like this one, that the veteran said, I could carry this thing with me everywhere for just a quick, relaxing therapy session. We're seeing some reduction in pain and some SAIF-5 scores as well. So again, we don't have a lot of meaningful data to pull yet. Our 90-day follow-up, hopefully within the next couple of months, we'll start to see some of that as that trickles in. So more to come on that. Some of our lessons learned, one of the things that I didn't see coming is that we needed to better define first and subsequent VR session within our notes. I got so many calls on this, like, what does first mean? What does subsequent mean? So we just added a quick little definition there for our providers. We also needed more education, so we created those open hours, like I talked about. And again, our data report, we wish we would have built that just a little bit sooner. And that we had an oversight, a really bad oversight, some might say. Home-based primary care called us in January and they said, hey, we see that, you know, you've went live with this home use process. We don't have a headset or any headsets available to evaluate our patients in home-based primary care. Can we get in on this? And we looked at each other and we were like, of course. What were we thinking, right? So think about all your different services as you create your process. We were able to quickly get them on board. We got some headsets for them, and now they're evaluating folks in the home as well. And then just some documentation tweaks that we had to do as we got some feedback from providers. And looking to learn for the future, talked about this in conversation with some different folks already. We don't know what we don't know, and we're comfortable telling you that we don't have all of the answers. This is new. This is something that we are learning. This is something that we hope to be able to share with other sites really soon. We don't know what the future looks like. You know, Matt and I were talking about utilizing headsets. What happens in 6 months if a veteran says, I dropped it in the toilet. I need a new headset. It's a real possibility, right? Are we going to have some sort of directive that kind of guides that in the future? I don't know. We might. What will that follow-up look like? Will it need to be more than 90 days? Or will it need to be 180 days? Or will it need to be twice a year? Will there need to be some sort of guidance on issuance of one headset every year, one headset every 5 years? I don't know. I don't know what that looks like. We're all going to kind of learn that together. What will the process look like if you have devices in the home that need updating? You know, the software goes bad or the software is now obsolete. I don't know. We'll figure it out as we move forward. What does the future funding look like? I'll just leave that there. I think all of us in VA can just leave that there. And then the addition of different and more VR headset options. So again, I mentioned we went live with just one headset. We're going to be adding more. But as we add those additional headsets, we have to remember to keep all those things in consideration, like privacy, Wi-Fi, ease of use, and things of that sort. I'm out of time. Here is our contact information. We just added our third innovation specialist to our team, which is really exciting. We have created a toolkit, so we're happy to share that out with you if you're interested in sharing and having the console, the templates, the tools to implement this at your site. Feel free to reach out.